What's going on, all my healthcare brothers and sisters? I hope that you are having a wonderful day. My goal is to help you pass your NCLEX and your nursing school exams like a boss. And today, we're going to be looking at hypomagnesemia. Let's get our electrolyte on. So in order to understand electrolyte imbalances, we have to understand what the electrolyte is. So what is magnesium? Well, a normal range for magnesium is between 1.8 to 2.6 milliequivalents per liter. And the main functions of magnesium is 60% of magnesium is stored in bones and cartilage. So we have skeletal muscle contractions, specifically in our uterus and heart. Those are the two organs that are greatly impacted by magnesium. It helps immune system support, regulates blood glucose levels, as well as carbohydrate metabolism. It is ultimately helping with the activation of our vitamins, ATP formation and cellular growth are another huge main function for magnesium. And it has a direct relationship with calcium. Like we talked about before in our calcium series, magnesium and calcium are best friends. When one goes up, the other one is gonna go up. Whereas with phosphorus, they are not best friends. So if phosphorus is low, calcium and magnesium will go up. Whereas with phosphorus is high, magnesium and calcium will go down. So what is hypomagnesemia? Hypo means low, magnesemia means magnesium in the blood. So we have low magnesium in the blood. So we're going to see low serum magnesium levels. That's gonna be less than 1.8 milliequivalents per liter. And there's quite a few causes that can cause hypomagnesemia, starting with our first category, insufficient magnesium intake. So with our malnutrition and starvation patients, they're not getting anything in, they're not able to get in that magnesium, so they're going to ultimately have low serum magnesium levels. NG suctioning. Anytime you have NG suctioning, it really messes up with all of your electrolytes. So you really need to be monitoring your patient's electrolytes whenever you have them on NG suctioning, especially continuous NG suctioning. Vomiting and diarrhea. Magnesium is ultimately lost in the stool, so you're going to see massive losses of magnesium with our patients that have diarrhea. Malabsorption syndrome is the body's inability to absorb magnesium, so that can also be another cause, as well as celiac disease and Crohn's disease can cause magnesium losses. Another category, increased magnesium excretion. So medications such as diuretics, as we know, a lot of our diuretics are electrolyte wasting, so you can have a decrease in magnesium. Chronic alcoholism is the most common cause in addition to renal failure. But when it comes to chronic alcoholism, it really inhibits the body's ability to reabsorb magnesium in the GI tract. So when you've got your CWA patients that are coming in that are chronic alcoholics, you really want to make sure that you're monitoring their serum electrolytes to see what's going on with those magnesium levels. And then of course, like we said before, renal failure is also another big cause of hypomagnesemia. And our last category is intracellular movement of magnesium. So when it comes to our aminoglycosides, hyperglycemic patients, insulin administration, as well as sepsis, all play a major role in how magnesium is distributed in our body. So with hypomagnesemia patients, what is our patient going to look like? Well, they're going to be unable to maintain order in their system and everything is going to go insane. It's going to go crazy. So when it comes to our cardiovascular system, we're going to see those tachycardias, hypertension, those cardiac dysrhythmias. If you have hypomagnesemia, you're going to see something called torsades de Pointes. And it is a type of ventricular tachycardia where it kind of looks like it's spindling. And that is highly seen with our hypomagnesemia patients. So really we wanna make sure that we're giving them magnesium to help correct that specific cardiac dysrhythmia. When it comes to our respiratory system, we're going to have rapid, shallow respirations because again, the body's unable to maintain order and everything's just kind of going crazy. So they're gonna have those rapid, shallow respirations. The neuromuscular system, a lot of the stuff that you see with hypomagnesemia, you're going to see in hypocalcemia, because remember, they're best friends. So you're going to see those muscle twitching and paresthesias, that positive Trousseau sign, because again, they have a direct relationship. So with Trousseau's, when you inflate a blood pressure cuff, their hand is going to kind of flex And sometimes it can either go like this or it can go outwards. So you're going to see that with trousseaus, and you're gonna have a positive Chagas sign. So again, direct relationship with calcemia. When you stroke the side of a patient's facial nerve, their mouth is gonna kind of go towards that facial nerve. So that is a positive sign when it comes to hypomagnesemia. Hyperreflexia is a big one, as well as tetany and seizures are seen with those low magnesium levels. So when it comes to our central nervous system, we're going to have irritability and confusion with our patients. And then lastly, laboratory findings. So you're gonna have serum low magnesium levels less than 1.8 milliequivalents per liter, and you're going to see electrocardiogram changes. So you're gonna ultimately see tall T waves, depending on how severe that low magnesium is, depressed ST segments, and you're gonna see one of two rhythms. So we already talked about one, which is Torsades de Pointes. That's a huge NCLEX tip. And that's the first strip that you see here on the slide. So it's kind of a spindling effect of our ventricular tachycardia. That's where we get this Torsades de Pointes. And you can ultimately also see ventricular fibrillation if it is highly severe. If you have a high loss of magnesium, your ventricles are going to go crazy, and that fibrillation is going to occur in your ventricles, ultimately leading to ventricular fibrillation. So what are we gonna do? What are we as nurses going to intervene with our hypomagnesemia patients? So ultimately the goal is to replace that magnesium, but if we replace that magnesium, we also need to replace that calcium, right? So we're going to replace magnesium and calcium, IV and PO. Hypocalcemia, as we know, accompanies hypomagnesemia. Interventions, we're going to aim at restoring both magnesium and calcium levels. So when we're administering calcium IV, we want to warm that injection fluid to body temperature because it helps with that discomfort, because giving calcium is not very comfortable for our patients. So make sure that you warm it to body temperature before you administer the medication, as well as you want to administer it slowly. Like with any electrolyte, we don't want to rapidly overcorrect, so we really need to make sure that we are administering it appropriately and slow. We want to monitor for electrocardiogram changes, as well as infiltration and hypercalcemia, as well as hypermagnesemia, because we can go in the opposite direction. We want to provide vitamin D if we're giving calcium PO. And when we're administering magnesium IV, we want to give the medication slowly, no more than 1 gram per hour, because it can slow down the heart rate to the point where we're bradycardic or we go into cardiac arrest. So you really want to make sure that when we're giving these electrolytes, we're giving them slow so that we don't overcorrect them too quickly. We want to initiate seizure precautions. We want to monitor serum magnesium levels. And we also want to monitor for diminished deep tendon reflexes, because that ultimately suggests that we are heading in the opposite direction and we're moving into a hypermagnesemia phase. We never, ever want to give IM magnesium because it can cause pain as well as tissue damage. So make sure that when we're giving this, we're giving it IV. We also want to treat hypomagnesemia before we treat hypokalemia. Why do we want to do this? It's because if the body is in a state of low magnesium, it's unable to process and absorb the potassium. So it doesn't matter how much potassium you're going to give these patients, it's not even going to make a dent if we have low magnesium. So you want to make sure, if you were doing electrolyte replacements, that you're always replacing that magnesium before we replace that potassium, so that way the potassium can be reabsorbed and ultimately help replace those electrolyte imbalances. Another intervention that we want to do is we want to discontinue medications that cause those magnesium losses, such as our diaphoretics and our phosphoruses, because like we said before, magnesium and phosphorus are going to have inverse relationships. So if we're giving phosphorus in the presence of low magnesium, it's only going to make it worse. And diuretics ultimately are electrolyte wasting, so we want to make sure that we're not giving those. And then we want to give the patient education in what magnesium-rich foods look like. So almonds, avocados, bananas, cauliflowers, green leafy vegetables, milk, peanut butter, peas, pork, beef, and chicken, as well as potatoes, are all magnesium-rich foods. I hope that this video was helpful for you in passing your nursing exams like a boss. If you have any questions, please feel free to leave them down below. I love answering your questions. Make sure that you follow me on my social media. I'm on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, as well as here on YouTube. Make sure that you subscribe as well as like this video. I also have a website at www.nursechung.com where I will have NCLEX style questions as well as additional resources with each of my videos. So make sure that you check that out. But until next time, I hope that you're having a wonderful day, and I will speak with you all again soon. Bye!